Solo, written and read by Pen Hadow. I flew into Resolute Bay on the 26th of February 2003, the last staging post on the way to the North Pole. My destination still lay over 1,000 miles to the north. Resolute Bay, also known as Kwasituk, a place with no dawn in the Inuit language Inuktitut, is a sheltered bay on the southern shores of Cornwallis Island, overlooking the ice-choked waters of the Northwest Passage. It did not even exist as a settlement until the late 1940s, when the Canadian government decided to lay formal claim to all the islands to the north of its mainland, and began setting up civilian settlements. Resolute Bay now has around 200 permanent inhabitants, together with a number of contract workers. But the only significant employers are the Polar Continental Shelf Project, an international scientific study centre, and the airport complex. The permanent population at Resolute mostly live at the Hamlet, a mile from the airfield, in the shadow of the rocky outcrop rearing 500 feet above the town. As I drove down the dirt road in a battered Ford pickup, I saw the lights of this forlorn, almost pointless village shimmering through the cold, dark haze of the late winter afternoon. Prominent among them was the steeple light of the tiny church. As I left the church on foot, the ferocious cold made me gasp for breath. At once I bumped into three old friends, Tony and Mavis Manick, and Diane Guy, wife of Gary, my Canadian base manager at Resolute. After a few minutes standing still, the cold was penetrating my bones. I left my friends at the church and hurried on through the snow-lined streets back to my car, walking fast to try and generate a little body heat. Driving back from the settlement, I hunched over the wheel, barely able to move, my body in a frigid semi-rictus, my sole focus to get back to the warmth and comforts of my base. I was going to be operating in these extreme temperatures, and worse, for months, and at the moment I could hardly cope inside a heated car. But I knew that I could quickly adapt, and it occurred to me then, as it has done at the start of every polar season, how remarkable the human body is in being able to adjust to almost any environment, natural or artificial, in peace or in war, for as long as is necessary. I was making my final preparations for the pole, and had to make sure that my chartered aircraft was ready and waiting. There's an old saying that yachting is like standing under a cold shower tearing up £50 notes. If so, chartering flights around the Arctic is like standing naked in a blizzard and throwing £10,000 bundles into the air. Over the previous 10 years, my flights in and out of Resolute for myself and the Polar Travel Company had cost in excess of £750,000. This year, one company, Kenbarrick Air, had a monopoly on the business, but the astronomical prices they charged were as much a reflection of the vast distances and the appalling conditions as of the lack of competition. I called in at the Borwick offices in Resolute Bay to renew acquaintances and make sure that they'd received my banker's draft for $100,000, the price of two flights, one to drop me off at Ward Hunt Island and the other, with luck, to collect me from the pole around 10 weeks later. I also finalised the dates and timings with the company's duty manager, Bill Galetz, and the duty pilot, Troy McCarroll. We agreed that I would be dropped off at Ward Hunt Island from 13th of March onwards, subject to weather. Given that I expected to take 65 days to reach the pole, I should therefore be arriving at the pole around the 16th of May. Provided that I arrived there between the 15th and 25th of May, and made my best efforts to do so in the earlier part of that 10-day window, they both declared themselves satisfied with the proposed schedule. It would be hard to exaggerate the sheer unending pressure of the last few days before the expedition began. The days passed in a blur, and the nights were short and restless. Early on the morning of my proposed departure date, 13th of March, Troy dropped by our base to report that poor weather over Ward Hunt Island and the midway refueling point at the Eureka High Arctic Weather Station would prevent us from flying that day. The next morning, Friday 14th of March, Bill Galetz phoned to confirm that weather conditions at Eureka and Ward Hunt Island were now satisfactory, and we were go to depart. Accompanied by Ian Wesley, my base manager, Martin Hartley, our photographer, and Jeannie Dougree, an English journalist, I boarded the aircraft, one of Ken Borick's fleet of de Havilland DHC-6 Twin Otters, the workhorses of the north. We took off at 7:30 in the morning and flew due north for almost 3 hours, the landscape far beneath us growing ever more barren and threadbare, as grey and apparently lifeless as a desert. I spent the first part of the flight deep in conversation with Ian about my mileage plan. The first part of the plan was merely a psychological trick. To break the 416 nautical mile distance, 1 nautical mile is equivalent to 1.151 statute miles, or 1.852 kilometres, into manageable portions of time as well as distance. I knew that 60 days travelling should pretty much crack it, so like the minutes of a clock face, I split the journey down into multiples of 5 days. My plan was to average 3 nautical miles a day over the first 20 days, the hardest in terms of ice and weather conditions, and made even more grueling because the sledge would then be at its heaviest. I would be travelling for no more than 5 or 6 hours a day in the early stages, reflecting the exhausting battle to drag the sledge over probably the hardest terrain, inverted commas, and the lowest temperatures that I would encounter. But as the weather and ice conditions improved and the sledge grew lighter, I was aiming to progressively increase the pace and the hours travelled to cover up to 10 nautical miles a day before the final push to the pole in the perpetual daylight of the polar summer, when I would be travelling for 15 hours or more every day. I gazed down at the familiar landscape as we flew north. It is undulating country at first, thickly blanketed with snow, but further north the landscape becomes much more dramatic. Pyramidal peaks and frost-shattered screes, huge glaciated valleys and densely crevassed glaciers, with broad tongues of vivid azure-blue ice spilling into the frozen sea. Some people talk about the Arctic as a monotonous wilderness of white, but if you open your eyes and really look at the landscape, especially at this time of year, you realise that there are no whites whatsoever to be seen. Everything is in shades and tones of pastel colours, and only in the stark, bright light at the height of the polar summer, when the sun is high in the sky, do you begin to see true whites among the other colours. By now, the snow-covered hills of Cornwallis and Devon Island had given way to the featureless sea ice of Norwegian Bay, and then we began the spectacular run up Eureka Sound, before landing to refuel at Canada's northernmost civilian outpost, at 79 degrees 59 minutes north on the west coast of Ellesmere Island, 601 nautical miles from the pole. We stayed no more than half an hour, then climbed back aboard for the final leg toward Hunt Island, a further 185 miles to the north. Although Ginny kept chatting to me all the way, I was lost in my own thoughts and replied only in monosyllables, if at all. For the next 10 weeks, I had to put the normal concerns and preoccupations behind me. I was focusing only on the journey ahead and the ultimate goal that lay beyond the ice. Progress north was the only criteria, and after all the months of preparation and the help and support of countless individuals and organisations, it was now down to me alone. We flew on. The scene beneath was of a land at the frontier of the habitable earth, stripped to its bare elements, rock, snow, and ice. And beyond even that lay the Arctic Ocean. In summer, its dark waters are littered with ice floes pocked with aquamarine pools of meltwater. In winter, it is bound in the rigid, unyielding embrace of the polar ice cap. Some visitors find the raw, elemental quality of the high Arctic landscape disturbing, and even frightening. I love it for precisely those reasons. It is desolate country, of course, but with its own subtle and haunting beauty. I had stopped even pretending to listen to the conversation now. I was deep within myself. Despite the unimaginable commitment and costs of getting to this point, I could not have claimed to be excited by what lay ahead. Instead, I was filled with dread. This was my third attempt. I had to succeed this time. It took an hour and a quarter to reach our destination. Ward Hunt Island, 3 miles off the northern shore of Ellesmere Island, at roughly 83 degrees and 5 minutes north, is no more than a couple of miles long and a mile or so wide. It is dominated by Walker Hill, a conical peak like an extinct...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.